Join me in prayer. Lord, we're grateful that we have the time and place and people to meet with tonight, that we can open your book and study the epistle to the Hebrews, and that we can learn from it, and that we can engage in learning about you and what you would have us understand in all of Scripture, which is profitable for our growth and our perfection. So we thank you, Lord, for your grace working in us, and I pray that it will continue to work in us as we minister together in the future. Amen. Okay. Tonight, Hebrews lesson number 2. The first lesson was before my brief hiatus, and so it was, a month ago, I think, that we covered the first introduction. So I'm going to strain your memory to recall what we talked about back then, which we'll deal with over the next few months in the book of Hebrews verse by verse. We talked then about what Hebrews was about. And that's going to be important for tonight's lesson as we talk about the authorship, because the authorship is a question. The authorship is confusing. And so we have to turn to the content of the book to know how to apply it. Okay? And so recall what that's about. We'll deal with more of that tonight as well. The authorship of Hebrews is the most contested issue in studying the book. And it's one of the first things you'll deal with when you start studying the book of Hebrews is who wrote it. Especially since we, who are dispensational, ask the question, who is writing, to whom are they writing, and are we in the audience? What are they writing about? And those three questions help develop the context of any passage of Scripture. And so that very first question that we ask, who's writing this book? Suddenly we don't know. We start going in circles. We don't know who wrote the book. And so there's been a lot of controversy about this over the last 2,000 years. And so it is an issue. It's interesting why it's an issue. And that's because authorship determines application of the doctrine, right? We've studied this before. When you study the book of James, for example, James chapter 1 verse 1 says, James, a servant of God and the Lord Jesus Christ, to the 12 tribes which are scattered abroad, greeting. Well, thank you, James, and thank you, God, for giving us that verse, because as we study the book of James, it tells us who wrote it, James, and to whom they wrote it to, which was the 12 tribes of Israel scattered abroad. So that's very helpful, and then all we have to do is read the rest of the epistle to learn what he wrote about and to see if we fit in the context. We already know who wrote it and to whom he wrote it. Hebrews is not like that. It doesn't give us the author anywhere. The first word in the book of Hebrews is God, which scholars have said kind of tongue-in-cheek in the past that, well, that tells us right there who wrote it. God wrote it. Okay, great. And we can settle that right there, and that's not a bad place to stay, by the way. 2 Timothy 3:16 says, all Scripture is given by inspiration of God. So Hebrews was inspired by God. It's in your Bible. If you're a Bible believer, that's good enough, okay? You're going to have to work at a disadvantage in that you don't know uniquely who the person was who wrote it. I wrote it down, but knowing that it is inspired, you can then determine from the context or from the content whether it's applied to you or not. But people debate who the author is, okay? Not as many people debate who wrote the book of Ruth. Not as many people debate who wrote the last six verses of the book of Joshua. You know, Joshua died in the last six verses of Joshua, so he couldn't have written the last six verses. But hardly anyone debates that as much. Hardly anybody debates who wrote Esther. You may think, well, Esther wrote it. Well, we just don't know that. We don't know who wrote it. There's a lot of people in Israel's history that could have written it. We just don't know. There's legends and there's theories, but you don't hear controversy so much about your belief in the authorship of Esther or Ruth or Joshua and that sort of thing, or the last few verses of Deuteronomy, which Moses couldn't have written because he died as well. But Hebrews, a lot more fire, a lot more controversial language. A lot of books have been written about this because if you can sway opinion to one side or the other about who wrote it, then you could sway your interpretation towards that. Specifically in the grace circles, who are mid-Acts, Pauline dispensational, it's extremely important for us to address this issue in part, because we are not like most, just say, well, the Old Testament's for Israel, the New Testament's for us. We don't take that position. We understand the difference between the Old Testament, the New Testament, and the revelation of the mystery of Christ. And so we understand that a revelation was given to Paul. So suddenly, the books of your New Testament in your Bible, we need rightly divide. We need to understand that there were epistles written by the 12 apostles to Israel. Then there was Paul's epistles. Well, Hebrews is right in the middle of them. Did Paul write it, or didn't he write it? And so that's the question we're going to deal with tonight uniquely. Who wrote it? Now, if you go to Galatians chapter 2, 7 through 9, as mid-Acts Pauline dispensationalists, you're familiar with this passage. If you're not, you are not familiar with this passage. But Galatians 2 deals with Paul going to Jerusalem and settling the issue over whether or not he had a rightful place to minister to Gentiles the gospel of the grace of God. And of course, he wasn't going there to get permission from the apostles, but simply to declare them to get off his doorstep. But in Galatians 2, verse 7, he says he went there, in verse 6, of these who seemed to be somewhat, whatsoever they were, it maketh no matter to me. God accepts no man's person. For they who seemed to be somewhat in conference added nothing to me. And so Paul says, these apostles in Jerusalem did not add anything to me. Okay, they didn't add anything to me. Okay, that's going to be helpful later as we deal with Hebrews chapter 2. Because in Hebrews 2, 3, and 4, apparently the author of the book of Hebrews has heard some things, learned some things from apostles that were in Jerusalem. Well, Paul says in Galatians 2, verse 6, they didn't add anything to me. So there was nothing that Paul taught that the apostles in Jerusalem taught him first. But in verse 7, he says, contrarywise, when they saw that the gospel of the uncircumcision was commended to me, as the gospel of the circumcision was unto Peter. And so in that verse, we learn in the King James Bible, there's two gospels, one to the uncircumcision, one to the circumcision, two separate ones. But he said, when they saw that, for he that wrought effectually in Peter to the apostleship of the circumcision, the same was mighty in me towards the Gentiles. And then he goes on, and we can pause there for a moment, as we see Paul admitting that he has an apostleship and authority to Gentiles from the same Lord and on the same level as Peter had apostleship and authority to go to who? Circumcision or Hebrews, right? And so we're studying the book of Hebrews. In Galatians 2, verse 8, it clearly shows that Paul went to Gentiles and Peter and those in Jerusalem went to the Jews, went to circumcision, okay? Now in verse 9, he says, when James, Cephas, and John, Cephas being Peter, so when James, Peter, and John, who seemed to be pillars, perceived the grace that was given unto me, they gave to me and Barnabas the right hands of fellowship, that we should go to the heathen, and they unto the circumcision. Only they would that we should remember the poor, the same which I also was for to do. So you see an agreement in verse 9 that the led by these three apostles as the head, and of course the rest of the apostles as well, and the entire ministry in Jerusalem, they would go to the circumcision. Those who were circumcised in heart and ears, those who had believed the Messiah, those who had followed Jesus in his earthly ministry, received the Spirit at Pentecost, okay, those who were in the ministry of Stephen and Philip, okay, they would go to them. And Paul, he would go to the heathen, those to whom Christ did not come. He would go to those who had rejected Christ, which at this time, according to Acts 7 and 8, include uncircumcised Israel, out in the synagogues, in the Gentile territories, who had rejected the Messiah. And he's going to go there too, and he's going to start preaching to them Christ. And so we see a difference between the apostles in Jerusalem going to the circumcision and Paul going to the heathen. And this is helpful when you look at the New Testament, because what you find is epistles written by these two groups of people. You have Paul with his 13 epistles, clearly identified that he wrote them, as the first word of each of those epistles is Paul, okay? And then you've got epistles from James and Peter and John, you know, 1st, 2nd, 3rd John. Jude was one of the 12 apostles, okay? Revelation written by John. And so in Galatians 2, verse 9, James, Peter, and John went to the circumcision. Who's the audience of James, Peter, John, Revelation, Jude? It would be the circumcision. It would be the Hebrews. And so again, this is a question then when we start to study Hebrews, because it doesn't declare who wrote it in the book. And so we have to make a decision on who we think wrote it, or does it matter, and why? And what does it matter? What does it affect? Okay. But in our toolbox of understanding is Galatians 2 verse 9, that Paul and the 12 apostles had an agreement. Paul would go to the heathen and the 12 would go to the circumcision. This immediately should give you some sort of a bias, I think, a prejudice to which group would possibly be writing to Hebrews, okay? If Paul wrote the book of Hebrews, there's a question then that comes from that. You know, what about that deal he made with the 12 apostles? What about him going to the heathen? You know, who's he speaking to in the book of Hebrews if Paul wrote it? But Paul is not the only suggested author of the book. In case you don't know, like I said, it's been a very controversial issue over the last 2,000 years. It has not been settled by any means. You'll find commentaries, when you start studying the commentaries on Hebrews, there'll be commentators that say that it's very clear, all the evidence points to Paul. You have another commentary and say, all the evidence points not to Paul. And so, I mean, this is how diverse the opinion is about who wrote the book of Hebrews, is they can't even agree on the evidence. But suggested authors throughout history have been Paul, of course, and the most popular and the most traditional. But Luke has also been an option. And that's actually the more recent popular opinion of who wrote the book of Hebrews. You'll be hard-pressed to find a scholar over the last 30 or 40 years who continues to hold the apostle Paul as the author of the book of Hebrews, unless it's from some traditional group. Okay, the modern scholars do not think Paul wrote it. Barnabas is an option. Tertullian in the 2nd and 3rd century thought Barnabas wrote it. Apollos is who Martin Luther thought wrote the book of Hebrews. He said Apollos is a pretty good candidate. Okay, Priscilla and Aquila, both of them, for various reasons. There's some feminists, some modern feminist scholars who say Priscilla wrote it, and that they hid her femininity. And that's why she didn't put her name on it, because, you know, women were oppressed and this sort of thing. And so you have this opinion out there as well. Clement of Rome is an ancient option. Silas, who traveled around with Paul. Peter's an option. John's an option that people have suggested. Okay, some people have proffered Philip or Stephen, which I think is interesting. Because as we studied Acts 7 and 8, remember what we were talking about the little flock in Jerusalem, how they were being kicked out, they were being dispersed out of Jerusalem. And we talked about the content of Hebrews being about Hebrews who no longer had an earthly city, and they were waiting for a heavenly one. And so I said, that's interesting, because it seems to talk about what's happening there when these believing Hebrews, these believing Jews, were being scattered out of the city in the kingdom that was supposed to be theirs on the earth. And so Stephen and Philip are interesting options, and we'll talk a little bit about that later. Epaphras is another companion of Paul, and Timothy has been considered as an option, especially with the footnote at the end of the book of Hebrews, which says it was written by Timothy. You say, well, isn't that clear that if it says it was written by Timothy that we know it is? Well, the footnote's not inspired, and that's the problems with that. But the footnote that is in some manuscripts and in some Bibles says Timothy wrote it. Mary is an option, and then Jude has been thrown out there as well. And I just give you these options, not as all of them being legitimate, okay, but simply to show you that the opinion is diverse about who wrote it, and scholars are not in consensus over this, okay, and people are not in consensus over it. And typically when you find someone being adamant about a singular person, there is going to be an agenda behind it, a bias, a prejudice, a doctrinal bias. And I expose my doctrinal bias to you already. Okay, I'm a mid-Acts Pauline dispensationalist, and so I understand the easier doctrinal truths that we can learn from Romans and Ephesians and Colossians about the uniqueness of the mystery in contrast to the 12 apostles. And so I come to Hebrews with that bias. And so when I see doctrine in the book of Hebrews that is unlike doctrine Paul would teach according to the mystery, and I see doctrine in Hebrews that aligns with the 12 apostles' ministry to Israel, then that biased my opinion about who wrote it, or at least under what pretense they wrote it, okay? So it's not wrong to have a bias if you're right. So you be persuaded in your own mind, you study to show yourself approved, okay? So tonight, the object of the lesson today is simply to go through some of the issues regarding the authorship and hopefully in your mind settle in part why it even matters, okay? So that we can proceed and study the actual content, okay? So as we talk about the issue of the authorship, and we try to determine who actually wrote it. How do we do that? How do we find out who wrote a book if it doesn't tell us plainly in the text? Well, you're going to have to study the content of the book, the internal evidence. You're going to have to study the historical evidence. You can't just ignore that entirely. You have to find out what people said. I mean, what are the options, right? And why do they hold to those things? You know, did Paul or Barnabas or Apollos leave some letter in history that says, oh yeah, and by the way, I wrote the book of Hebrews. You know, that would help. Is there some sort of external evidence? Is there some sort of doctrinal reason that we have to say one wrote it or the other? And again, this is what makes it even the more confusing, because there's simply not a lot of evidence to point to anybody. It's very sparse. There's some, but it can apply to lots of people. And so, again, it's not very specific. So what we come down to is hearsay, tradition, reading between the lines, assumptions. These are what involve the study of the authorship of Hebrews. And that's not a good place to be. Okay, it's not a good place to be studying hearsay, tradition, reading between the lines, and assumptions when you're trying to find out for certain something. So we're in uncertain ground right here. We're in uncertain territory. So be very careful to be adamant about the author of Hebrews. We simply do not know because the Bible doesn't tell us, okay, very clearly. So popularly repeated evidences for who and who wrote it was Eusebius, who wrote a popular church history back in the 3rd and 4th century. And Eusebius, in his church history, quoted Clement, who said he had heard that Paul said it, but Luke wrote it for him. And so I think that's kind of funny. You read someone who heard from someone else, who heard from someone that he said. I mean, it's just hearsay is what we're reading here. And so, yeah, you can, if you value historians and history, you can read that and say, wow, that's pretty strong evidence that Paul said it and Luke wrote it for him, you know. Well, how do we know that Eusebius got it right when he's talking about someone 200 years before you? It'd be like you saying that I heard that George Washington talked to someone and someone told him, you know, where his grandfather came from. Would you trust me if I said that? I mean, how would you know that I was right? Take that with a grain of salt, but that's where people get the idea historically that Paul wrote it. As Eusebius wrote it in his history about someone that said it 200 years before he did. And earlier on in history, there was dispute. Before Eusebius, like I said before, Tertullian was before Eusebius. He said Barnabas wrote it. And so there was debate. And Eusebius acknowledged that. He said that it's not agreed upon. There's different people and different opinions. And he said even if Paul wrote it, which most people think around Eusebius that he did, no one knows who actually penned it. You know, they thought maybe Paul gave the doctrine because they read Hebrews and they saw some similar doctrine, but they don't know who actually wrote it because they all agree that whoever wrote the words down wrote a different style than Paul did, so it didn't really look like Paul wrote it. So there's controversy even early on in history, so we can't trust very much the historians. They debated as well. They didn't quite know. One of the biases that we can see in the history is that when people were trying to put the Bible together, according to the historical tradition and the Catholic Church tradition, one factor they would take into consideration to putting a book in the Bible is whether or not it was written by an apostle. And of course, you and I have talked about the canon before, but they think that the church chose which books to put in, and so they think, well, Paul had to write it, else why would they put this book in the Bible? Paul was an apostle, right? Well, Peter was an apostle, John was an apostle, Barnabas was called an apostle. So he's not the only apostle, but also we know that the Bible wasn't put together just by the choice of men. They didn't set some books up and say, what's your favorite? Let's make these the Bible. Okay, the Bible was determined by Holy Spirit-filled people who wrote them and in the church who acknowledged what they wrote was of God. That's what 1 Corinthians 14 says. Okay, so be careful of studying things like that in history and saying, well, these guys who put the Bible together, they had this and that opinion. Well, they're not inspired of God. The only people inspired of God are the people who originally wrote the books that the Holy Spirit moved to write those words. That's what inspiration is called. Okay, everything else is preservation. Everything else is providence and history. Okay, so Tertullian, an early church father, said Barney wrote it. Barnabas wrote it. Okay, you read Tertullian about other doctrinal issues, you may not agree with what he said. But you consult him regarding Hebrews, can you trust him? Well, that's up to history. Martin Luther, over 1,000 years after Tertullian, said Apollos wrote it. Modern scholars say anybody but Paul. All we know is Paul didn't write it, and someone else had to. Okay, and we just don't know who. So that's the pieces on the table. If you look in your King James Bible, maybe we can take a little survey here in your Bible, what it says at the beginning of the book. In the Bible I have up here, on the title page of the book, it says the Epistle of Paul, the Apostle of the Hebrews. Anybody else? Anybody have anything different? Yours doesn't have anything? Just says Hebrews. Yeah, well, that's probably the best way to title it. But most people, just has something different?
It says the Epistle of the Hebrews, and it has that little paragraph about it, and it just, it doesn't really say.
Doesn't say. Paul, right, doesn't say it was Paul, yeah. Anybody else have anything different than saying that Paul wrote it? Yeah, well, in the 1611 edition of the King James Version, I mean, this is when the King James Bible was first printed, and many other Bibles, it has on the title page, the Epistle of Paul, the Apostle to the Hebrews. And for this reason, there's been a lot of King James believers who say, well, I believe every word in my King James Bible, and I know that Paul wrote it, and the reason why is because the title page says Paul wrote it, the Epistle of Paul to the Hebrews. I've had some people email me and say, about the paragraph marks and about the chapter numbers and the verse numbers, that they're all inspired of God, okay? And I tried to warn people against this idea because that's simply not true. Chapter and verses were not added to your Bible until after, was it 12 or 1300 AD? And so for over 1,000 years, they didn't have chapter and verse numbers in the Bible. Those were added when they started making the Bible more prevalent and printing and populating them to people so they could study it easier. And so they put the numbers in there so they can refer it to it easier. But before that, it was just one long continuous text. There was not chapter and verse numbers. The same thing with some book titles. Okay, they simply weren't there. In modern Bibles, you'll have little paragraph summaries in the text. That's not Bible either. Okay, those are added by your publisher. All right. Also, the Old and New Testament pages before Matthew 1 and Genesis 1, those aren't inspired of God. Those are added by the publisher to try to help you with the Bible study. The table of contents is not inspired of God. That was added by the publisher. And many other things in your Bible, and this may sound common sense to you, but many other things in your printed Bible are most likely not inspired. Okay? And now, I'm not talking about the text. I'm talking about things publishers add to your book to try to help. This is why, as much as possible, I encourage people to get a Bible without extras. Don't get a Bible with study notes, is what I encourage people, simply because if you don't know, it could confuse you. And you're reading God's Word, and then you skip to the bottom of the page, and you're reading some opinion from some outdated scholar. Okay? So I don't have Bibles with study notes that I use for reading. Okay? I have some with study notes that I use for reference, for the notes, but not. I don't want to get confused about what part is and is not God's inspired word. So just to make that clear, the subscript of the title, the Epistle of Paul the Apostle to the, is not part of the inspired text. Okay? That was something added because of tradition. It was the opinions of the translators. And so it's not something we can hold as authoritative evidence. Now, historical evidence, we can say, well, the King James translators thought it was Paul, right? But it's not part of the Bible. And so which evidence weighs more? We'll see later it has to do with the content. We need to figure out what the book is writing about to determine more about who wrote it, okay? Now, when it comes to this issue, it's interesting. The most popular mid-Acts dispensationalist of the 20th century, Cornelius Stamm, who wrote Things That Differ, was not a King James Bible believer, okay? And he made that clear in his memoirs when he said that King James Bible believers was the most dangerous thing to the grace movement, but also in all of his commentaries when he would correct the King James Bible when he intended to teach something that he thought was right. But regarding this issue, it's very interesting that Cornelius Stamm sounds very much like a King James Bible believer. Let me quote to you what he wrote in his book on Hebrews, which I don't really recommend. It's not really that good, but it says, the King James Version of the Bible, the translation authorized by King James and completed in 1611, this English version of the Bible entitles this epistle, the Epistle of Paul, the Apostle to the Hebrews. It must not be overlooked that more than 40 scholars in Greek and Hebrew participated in this work, and under God gave us the greatest translation of the Bible which the English-speaking world probably has ever possessed. The work was done with tenacious care by men who were ready to give up their lives for the truth of the Word. It was the Reformation Bible. And while they did not claim that the titles of Scripture were inspired, they certainly must, in view of the fact that the authorship has been questioned, have given tenacious and untiring deliberation to this question, taking all possible evidence into consideration. And this group of godly, learned men ascribe the authorship of Hebrews to Paul. This testimony should weigh heavily with sincere inquiries under this question. So there's Brother Stamm's opinion on the matter. I thought that's interesting. I about said amen just from defending the King James Bible, because on the next page he's going to correct it. But regarding the title and the authorship of it, he's all about these godly men who considered everything about the issue of who wrote Hebrews. So I thought that was kind of funny. He kind of loses all credibility with me when he goes on to say that the purpose of the book of Hebrews is threefold. Number one, to provide the solution to the believing Hebrews dilemma. Number two, to prove beyond a doubt that the mystery revealed through Paul and the dispensation of the grace of God committed to him were indeed God's eternal purpose. So number two, purpose of the book of Hebrews is to show that the mystery revealed to Paul was God's eternal purpose. Number three, to prove that God's blessings under grace are infinitely better than anything Israel or we ever knew or ever could know under the law. And so he makes two of the three purposes of the book of Hebrews explaining the mystery of Christ, which I think is hilarious because it's anything but explaining the mystery of Christ. It doesn't even mention the mystery of Christ or the dispensation of grace. Yeah, that's what he thinks the purpose is. So I show you that, read that to you, only to show you two things. One, he's the most popular meta-expositionalist of the last century. But number two, the bias that comes along with people's opinions about who wrote it, the doctrinal bias. He wants to apply the doctrine of this book to the church, and therefore he is biased against his other opinion about the King James Bible to say Paul wrote it. Because Paul is our apostle, and he knows that, and he's the apostle of the Gentiles, so the apostle of the church. And if Paul wrote it, then he can take that doctrine and apply it to us. Okay, so be careful and be able to careful to recognize people's biases and from which they come. Just don't take everything at face value. And the same goes for me. Okay, do your own study of it and your own thought of it. Study the book of Hebrews along with this and see what you think the purpose of this book is about. And whether you agree the purpose of this book is about explaining the eternal purpose of the mystery or whether it has to do with Israel and their kingdom come. Okay, but we'll get more to that in the months to come. So anyway, you'll find commentaries on every side of the issue that say there's no evidence for fill in the blank. There's no evidence for anybody else but Paul being the author. Or there's no evidence for Paul being the author. Well, they're just men, and that's their opinion, and it's kind of funny that they all think they all have the evidence on their side. So trying to be a little unbiased tonight, I'll try to show you the evidence for and against Paul, and then we'll move on, knowing that none of it is really that conclusive. Except that Paul most likely did not, or at least likely did not. So looking for signs of Paul, let's start with that. Brother Stamm says that Paul wrote the book of Hebrews. Eusebius thought so. Many others in Christian history have thought so. Your King James Bible says so at the top of the title page. So why? Why do people think, why does tradition say that Paul wrote the book? Okay, you all read Hebrews before, right? Why would you think that people would think that Paul wrote the book of Hebrews? Not a rhetorical. All right, nobody knows. Okay. Well, the simple reason is because you read the book of Hebrews and you find all over it discussion about Jesus and the blood and his death on the cross, right? You read Hebrews and have you read it and often been a little questionable? Well, wait a minute, that sounds kind of like Paul. You see, it's very easy to read this book and say, I think Paul wrote it, especially when you read things about the Old Testament law, and the author of the book of Hebrews says, oh, the law, that's going away, and the law, that's old, and the temple, those are old, and the sacrifices, those are old. And it talks about these newer things, right, these better things. Well, who talks about stuff like that? Well, Paul does, right, all over the place. He talks about the oldness of the law and how the law can't help you, and you're not under the law, and he gives you something else. Well, Hebrews does the same thing. And so it's not very hard, and so we can't just say, well, it's obvious to anybody who reads this book that Paul didn't write it. Well, it's really not. You read the book of Hebrews, and it may not be obvious at face value, especially if you don't rightly divide. And we started out with an understanding of right division. But if you don't rightly divide, I can see where you have trouble with it. Okay, I can see where you think Paul wrote it because Hebrews talks about a change. And we discussed this in our introduction last time, that Hebrews is a transition book. Talking about a change for the Hebrews from the Old Covenant to the New Covenant, right? A change of the Hebrews from their earthly temple and tabernacle to a heavenly temple and tabernacle. From the old law to a new law, from the old sacrifice to the new sacrifice. And so there's a transition, right? There's a replacement, a change going on, right? And the majority of Christians who think we are, you know, Old Testament for Israel, New Testament for the church, Hebrews is about us, right? So why wouldn't Paul be the one that writes it? Okay, so it explains that doctrinal change away from Israel's law, away from the city. Remember when I suggested in the introduction that this book was about that little flock who was being scattered out of the city because they were being persecuted. So Philip and Stephen, as they were ministering outside the city there to people in Israel, the Samaritans and the Ethiopian eunuch, and they were ministering to them, Jesus Christ and the kingdom. And Hebrews, I suggested, was written in that context, which is why we interrupted the book of Acts right there to put Hebrews, our Hebrew study here, okay? And so it explains those doctrinal changes away from the city of Jerusalem as they look back and say, well, I thought Christ said that the kingdom was going to come in Jerusalem. Well, Hebrews explains we're looking for a better city, one that comes from heaven, right? And so Hebrews explains to them what the better things are. So it talks about the blood of Jesus. It talks about his death. It talks about the better things. In fact, I was talking to someone, I think my dad a few weeks ago, about how the word blood is mentioned more time in the book of Hebrews than any one of Paul's epistles. So if you're doing a study of the word blood, you find it more often in the book of Hebrews than any one of Paul's epistles. And isn't our gospel the shed blood of Jesus Christ, payment for our sins, you know, his death and resurrection? So that's interesting. There's actually some questions and some response you may get when you say that we study Paul's epistles alone, and I don't think Paul wrote Hebrews. They'll say, well, how can you say that when, you know, Hebrews says to the Hebrews that Christ shed his blood for their sins, you know? And so here you are as mid-expensationalist going, blah, 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 I don't know, right? So if you're a mid-expensationalist, like Brother Stam, if you say Paul wrote Hebrews, that's a pretty good answer. So as you're responded to saying, well, Hebrews says Christ died for his sins, I can say, well, yeah, Paul wrote it. The mystery was given to Paul, and so, yeah, only Paul wrote that. So if Paul wrote Hebrews, it actually makes it a lot easier for me to explain responses to mid-expensationalism, because I can say that every time you find that word blood in Hebrews, that was Paul writing that. So, you see, Peter didn't know it. Paul knew it. That's why he had to write that book, not Peter. Right? So it's a pretty easy response just to clean up that mess. Okay? The problem, of course, is that by giving that easy response, you've now caused bigger problems down the road. Okay, because initially you've dealt with the mess, you think, but then suddenly you've put the church and you underneath Israel's covenants and law and kingdom and everything else. So there's going to be problems down the road. Okay, and that's what we're seeing, I think, in the grace movement, by the way, just on a bigger scale, is that nobody really questioned Stam's response to the Hebrew epistles because he was taking such a strong and clear stand on Paul's apostleship and the separation of Paul from Peter in early Acts and Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, teaching some of the same things we teach today. Okay, but since he made Paul the author of Hebrews, and since he said that the 12 learned from Paul the mystery, and so we can learn the mystery from James and Peter and John, that it's causing problems as we're further down the road. Okay. Because as we're seeing, people are now questioning how they ought to live in the Spirit, and they try to put themselves back under the law unknowingly, thinking they live under a covenant and applying kingdom truth to them. And they get that from seeds that were planted from ministries who said the Hebrew epistles apply to us. Okay? So it has consequences that we need to be aware of. And so we shouldn't be so quick to say, Paul wrote it. Okay? And we also ought to consider why people say that he did. So Hebrews does talk about transition, talks about the death and blood of Jesus. It talks about changing to new things. But we need to understand, as I think we talked about this two Sundays ago, that there's just not the Old Testament and the New Testament. And if that were the case, it was just the Old and the New, you got to pick one, right? But there's a third thing. There's the fellowship of the mystery. Okay? The mystery of Christ. And so there's three things that are in your Bible. The old covenant was made with the house of Israel, house of Judah. The new covenant was made with the house of Israel and house of Judah. And the fellowship of the mystery was given to Christ to send to Gentiles, all men, Jew or Gentile, in which Paul teaches there is no Jew or Gentile in the mystery body, in the body of Christ, the church. Okay? So when you understand there's three things, when Hebrews teaches away from the old, in with the new, you got to ask, well, which new thing is it talking about? The new thing here for Israel, or this new thing that Christ revealed to Paul? You see, because there's two new things that were going on. There's the new thing that God gave to Israel for his earthly purpose on the earth through Jerusalem and Israel. Then there's that new thing that was hidden from the world since the world began that he revealed to the Apostle Paul. And so it's this difference that people don't grasp, this right division. And this is why Hebrews is so hard for people, is they don't see a difference here. They think all of this is just one thing, and that's the old thing. So you see what we're getting at here? So when you rightly divide the new covenant fellowship with mystery, it makes Hebrews a lot easier because you have a choice now to make. Is it new covenant or a mystery? And that's an easy call to make. Read the book of Hebrews. It mentions the new covenant all over the place and does not mention this mystery fellowship at all. Okay? And so Hebrews is that description of the better things for Israel. All right? Now, in the book of Hebrews, you say, why or what part of this book, apart from, you know, the blood and the death and the better things, I mean, is there any clues in this book that hint that Paul wrote it at all? Okay? And there really is not, except for the last five or six verses. If you look at Hebrews 13, the last chapter of the book in verse 20 through 25. It's this ending of the book, this last paragraph, that you find the most evidence that people think Paul wrote it. okay, if there is any. Now, it doesn't say anything about Paul himself, but there's these circumstances. It's called circumstantial evidence, if you know law, right, that Paul may have wrote it. Hebrews 13:20, it says, "Now the God of peace that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus." That phrase, God of peace, for example, you only find it in Paul's epistles and right here in Hebrews. So who uses that phrase, God of peace? Well, Paul does three or four times, and the author of Hebrews does right here in Hebrews 13:20. Okay. Then it goes on to say, that brought again from the dead our Lord Jesus, that great shepherd of the sheep, through the blood of the everlasting covenant. Well, that doesn't sound like Paul at all. Who uses the word shepherd referring to Jesus in the Bible? Not Paul. Peter does. Right? Peter talks about that. And who talks about putting us under an everlasting covenant? Not Paul. John does in Revelation. You know, not Paul. So you see the confusion right here already in Hebrews 13:20. People see Hebrews 20, though, and 21, and they say this could be Paul. Verse 21, make you perfect in every good work to do his will, working in you that which is well-pleasing in his sight. Now, this is an interesting verse. We'll get to it months down the road, but it says that he's talking about the God of peace that will make you perfect in every good work to do his will. Okay? This is the end of the book of Hebrews, a prayer, a concession that God would make you perfect to do good works. And what's the book of James about? Faith without works is dead. So whereas Hebrews 13:21 ends with this prayer, this salutation that God would make you perfect in every good work, James explains for the audience how faith without works is dead and what works they need to do, which is the law. Okay, it was interesting there. Doesn't sound like Paul there, but let's move on. Verse 22, I beseech you, brethren, suffer the word of exhortation, for I have written a letter unto you in few words. That word of exhortation is a fascinating phrase there in Hebrews 13:22. If you look at Acts 13, in Acts 13, in verse 15, Acts 13, verse 15, this is early on in Paul's ministry, Acts 13, 15, and him and Barnabas have been separated to do the work the Holy Ghost called them to do, and they're out ministering, and they're in a synagogue here at Antioch. In Hebrews 13, 15, they're in a synagogue, and after the reading of the law and the prophets, the rulers of the synagogue sent unto them, saying, ye men and brethren, if you have any word of exhortation for the people, say on. Then Paul stood up, and he beckoned with his hand. He goes on to preach this sermon that's in Acts 13 about Israel's history and how Jesus fulfills the prophecies and the law and things like that. Okay. That phrase, word of exhortation, the only other place in the Bible that shows up is in Hebrews 13, verse 22. Some people think, well, that means the book of Hebrews could have been a sermon Paul preached in a synagogue to Hebrews. Maybe. Maybe. Okay. Does that mean we know for certain Paul wrote it? Nope, doesn't mean that at all. Can someone else use the phrase word of exhortation? Yeah, they can. In fact, in Acts chapter 4, there was a guy whose name was son of exhortation. In Acts chapter 4, in verse 36, there was a man named Barnabas, which is being interpreted the son of consolation or exhortation, a Levite, into the country of Cyprus. And so he's a Levite, he's a Jew, he's part of Peter's group, the kingdom group, and he's named the son of consolation. Okay, that word consolation means exhortation, consolation, comfort. Hebrews 13:22 is a word of exhortation. Some people say Barnabas wrote it. Could be. Just as much evidence as Paul. You see, we can't know conclusively one way or the other according to this verse or that verse. But verse 23 is a kicker. Verse 23 is a kicker. Know ye that our brother Timothy is set at liberty, with whom, if he comes shortly, I will see you. Timothy? Whoa. Paul wrote two epistles to Timothy. So Hebrews 13:23, people say, well, Paul wrote the book. That settles it. It settles it right there conclusively. All the evidence points to Paul. Why? Because the writer mentions Timothy. Okay. Question. How many Timothys were there in the first century? One? We just don't know. Okay. Well, you say, oh, surely in the Bible there's not that many. Well, there's three or four Marks. There's a few Marys. We don't know which Timothy it is, but it's true. Timothy was a companion of Paul. But here's another question. Could anyone else hang out with Timothy, or did only Paul hang out with Timothy? Because, you know, Barnabas was with Paul and Timothy, and Silas was with Paul and Timothy, and Luke was with Paul and Timothy. So Paul wasn't the only one that hung out with Timothy. He wasn't the only companion of Timothy. And so when Hebrews 13:23 says our brother Timothy, well, how many people were Timothy's brother? Lots of people. So again, it doesn't prove conclusively that Paul wrote it. In fact, there's lots of times where Paul mentions Timothy in his epistles, and he doesn't call him brother, he calls him son. So is this proof conclusively that Paul wrote it? It's not. Okay? Could it be? Maybe. We simply don't know. The Bible doesn't tell us who wrote the book of Hebrews, you see. But these are the most the weightiest verses in the book of Hebrews. People think Paul wrote it. Verse 24, salute all them that have the rule over you and all the saints. They of Italy salute you. Wham! Italy. Apparently the author is in Italy. Well, Paul went to Rome. Did anybody else go to Rome? Yeah. But in the Bible, of the other authors that we have in the scripture, Paul went to Rome, right? You know if Peter went there? The Catholics think so. Did John ever go there? Did Barnabas ever go there? You know, we just don't have record of it. So you see, this is how the game is played. When we don't have a clear verse, people speculate with what they have. And what they have is limited knowledge. Okay, we just don't have enough information, you see. Who is this from Italy? It doesn't say Rome, it says Italy. Could it not be in Rome, but some other town in Italy? It could be, we just don't know. Apparently the book's written from Italy. And apparently the person writing the book knows Timothy. Why wouldn't he? Timothy went to Rome with Paul. He was there. Timothy traveled around as well. Timothy was in Ephesus, okay? In fact, anybody have the footnote in their Bible after verse 25? Anybody have that? Yeah. These footnotes at the end of these epistles are not inspired text, okay? They're added through tradition and through later history. But it says, written to the Hebrews from Italy by Timothy. That's interesting. Because he mentions Timothy in verse 23. So if he mentions Timothy, is he talking in the third person? What's going on there? You know, some people think, in fact, Eusebius thought this, or not Eusebius, but Brother Ruckman, rather, down from Florida, thinks that Hebrews 1 through 12 was written by Paul, and Hebrews 13 was written by Timothy or Luke, someone else. So they split it up that way. That's what scholars do. They kind of like split the Bible up when it doesn't fit their theory, you know. So again, you see that we really can't just tell conclusively by some of these verses. What about the very last verse in Hebrews 13? Grace be with you all. Grace be with you all. Amen. This is how the book ends. Grace be with you all. And that's significant because in every one of Paul's epistles, at the end of his epistle, he talks about grace and peace be with you all. Well, Paul ends his epistles with that, and Hebrews 13 ends with grace be with you all. Look at 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. 2 Thessalonians chapter 3. Is there any way we can tell that Paul wrote this book? Paul does say in 2 Thessalonians, there's a token that he gives in all of his epistles. What's the token? Here's another controversy for you. 2 Thessalonians 3:17. The salutation of Paul with mine own hand, which is the token in every epistle, so I write. What's the token? Is it the name Paul? Because he's the salutation of Paul with mine own hand. He writes his name. In fact, in every one of Paul's epistles, the very first word of the epistle is Paul. Paul, an apostle. Paul, a servant. Why did he write his letters like that? I mean, when you write a letter to someone, if you write letters anymore, you know, people don't write letters anymore. But if you were, would you start out with your name? You know, Justin. No, I'd start out with their name, you know. Why would Paul start with his name? And that was because there were people writing letters in Paul's name that were forgeries, that were wrong, that were incorrect. And so he had to authenticate what he was writing. So he starts out his letters with Paul. This is my name. And he writes it. And he says in 2 Thessalonians 3:17, the salutation of Paul with mine own hand. So even though some epistles, there were people writing for him, he would always sign with his hand so they could see his handwriting, his signature. The salutation of Paul with mine own hand, which is the token of every epistle, so I write. And so you see Paul's name in 2 Thessalonians. You see Paul's name in the book of Colossians. If you turn left a few pages in Colossians 4, verse 18, the salutation of by the hand of me, Paul. Remember my bonds. Grace be with you. Amen. Those last five words are the same words you find in the book of Hebrews. So what's the token? What's the salutation that Paul is talking about? Is it his signature? Is it his name? Or is it that phrase, grace be with you all? Amen. Grace be with you. Amen. Because if it's the grace be with you, amen, then Hebrews 13, 25, that's exactly what that says. And maybe Paul's given us a hint. Maybe it's like, you know, I didn't put my name at the beginning, but at the end, there it is. And that's what people think. They think, well, he didn't put his name at the beginning. Why wouldn't he do that? Well, Eusebius said that Clement said that someone else said that he did not put his name on it because he feared the Jews. or rather, he didn't want the Jews to reject his epistle. He knew that they didn't like him very much because he went to Gentiles, and so he didn't put his name on the book of Hebrews so that they would read it first, you know, and they would just reject it outright, which I think is kind of hilarious. Now, I know Eusebius said that Clement said that someone else said that. I get that hearsay, but you know, I love saying that because this is how really people make their decisions about history, but I get that, but it doesn't really follow with my picture of Paul, and I'm not the authority on anything, but you read Paul's epistles, it doesn't seem to me Paul was that scared of people. I mean, the guy went to people's, he went to the temple in Jerusalem and like just walked in and started like doing stuff. You know, he would like go into the synagogue and start preaching about Gentiles and Jesus. It doesn't seem to me he's that afraid of people. And many times Jews chased him out of cities and stoned him and beat him up and cast him into prison. Why then would he write an epistle? Because he didn't want the Jews to reject his name, you know. And if that were true, that he had that motivation, that he was going to write an epistle kind of anonymously so they would read it, you know, why would you read an anonymous epistle? And wouldn't it be counterproductive if you signed the epistle with the same salutation you signed the rest of your epistles? And wouldn't it be counterproductive if Peter acknowledged that you wrote the book of Hebrews? I mean, what? So if it's true that Paul wanted anonymous, shouldn't it be anonymous and not any clue at all? So you see, it seems that doesn't really make any sense, but some people have that explanation as well. They say, well, Paul wanted it to be a secret. Well, I think God wanted it to be a secret, and we just don't know who wrote it, is what I think. But Colossians 4:18, 2 Thessalonians 3:17, Paul apparently signs his epistles, and we don't see his name anywhere in the Hebrews 13. Okay, we see words that Paul uses, but look at Revelation 22:21. People say, well, that last five words, that does it for me. I mean, Paul ends his epistles with that phrase, every one of his epistles. Well, so does John, Revelation 22:21. The grace of our Lord Jesus Christ be with you all, amen. Whoops. Well, maybe John wrote it, right? That's what Brother McLean says in his commentary on Hebrews, maybe John wrote it. John has the most writing in the Bible than any other person except for Paul. He has the Gospel of John. He's got 1 John, 2 John, 3 John, Revelation. Why not Hebrews, you know? Hebrews starts out similar to the Gospel of John, where John 1 says, in the beginning, you know, there was the Word, and the Word was with God. And well, Hebrews starts out with God and how Jesus is God and everything else. So maybe John wrote it. Okay, both of them mention the word begotten. And so you have similar language with John in Hebrews. So you see that there's opinions a many. Look at 2 Peter chapter 3, verse 15. This is one passage that people go to and say, well, this proves that Paul wrote it. 2 Peter 3:15. Now, 2 Peter, I've mentioned to you before, is the only epistle in Hebrew epistles that we can know for certain that was written after Paul, because Paul's name is mentioned in this epistle. No other Hebrew epistles Paul mentioned except for in 2 Peter, where in 2 Peter, Peter references Paul in his epistles. Now, 2 Peter is written to Peter's audience, the circumcision, about how the kingdom hasn't come yet. Peter taught the kingdom come in Acts 2 and 3. Kingdom comes soon, by the way. And it had not come. This has to be decades later because now Paul is saved and Paul's been ministering, so it's decades afterward. And the kingdom hasn't come. And so Peter is writing this second epistle, and he's saying, guys, I wasn't lying to you. I was telling the truth. And God is going to bring back his kingdom. He is going to come back as the Messiah. Okay? And he starts talking about what's happening here in the interim, meaning, you know, why is God delaying his return? Right? And he says in 2 Peter 3, he's not slack concerning his promise in verse 9, as some men count slackness, but is long-suffering to us, not willing that any man should perish, but all should come to repentance. So his explanation for why Jesus is delaying his return is so that salvation can be preached to people. Okay? Now, where does he get this idea? Where does Peter get this idea? He says, I get it from Paul. And down in verse 15, he says, we account that the long-suffering of our Lord is salvation, even as our beloved brother Paul, also according to the wisdom given unto him, hath written unto you. And so it's that verse right there that people say, oh, that's interesting. So Peter learned something from Paul about why Christ is delaying his kingdom, because Paul's talking about the dispensation of grace and the delay in the kingdom. But, you know, Peter says that our beloved brother Paul has written unto you, unto his audience here. Okay? People see that and say, well, where would Paul write to them? Romans, Corinthians, Galatians, Philippians, Colossians, you know, where's your, oh, Hebrews. Maybe he wrote Hebrews to the Hebrews. And that's really the extent of their reasoning there. The problem, of course, is, it says in verse 16, as also in all his epistles. So does Paul talk about the content of Hebrews in all of his epistles? The answer will clearly be no, he doesn't. So maybe Hebrews isn't. My point being, you just can't really say this conclusively. Not to mention, doesn't Paul address Jews in Romans 2:17 when he says, "Thou art called a Jew"? And Romans 9 through 11, when he's talking about the reason why Jews didn't receive their kingdom. In Romans 11, how in this time there's salvation being preached, but Israel's going to get their kingdom in the future. It seems to me Romans 9 through 11 is a clear explanation of what Peter's talking about here, which is the long-suffering of the Lord being salvation. So, again, 2 Peter is not conclusive. We know that Peter wrote about the delay of the Lord, or Paul wrote about the delay of the Lord, and Peter acknowledges that, but Peter doesn't say he wrote the book of Hebrews. Okay, it doesn't say that clearly. It doesn't say that directly. And as I mentioned before, if Paul wrote the book of Hebrews, it may initially solve some of these issues where you see these verses and say, oh, that makes sense. So you have Timothy there, you got Italy, you got 2 Peter 3. Paul wrote it. That's how I explain those verses. Okay. Well, how do you explain the fact that the author of Hebrews thinks he's going into a kingdom and waiting for a city to come down from the earth and thinks he's in part of the everlasting covenant and thinks that he has to endure to be saved? And what makes you think that he can lose his salvation, lose his forgiveness if he sins willfully against the Spirit? You see, this doesn't sound like Paul at all. So we can't just be quick to say Paul wrote it because it may solve some simple verses for us. So we have to look at the audience. If we can't see anywhere in the scripture that clearly says Paul wrote the book, then we have to just study the audience of the book, the content of the book. We can't trust the author. There's no verse that tells us the author to tell us that the book applies to us. We have to study the content and say, well, what is it talking about? And does the doctrine apply to us? So how do you know if the doctrine applies to us? Well, you have to study other books of the Bible. You study Paul's books that we know he wrote for today and for our dispensation and see if Hebrews aligns with that or not. You see, this is why Hebrews could be a trouble book for people. So we have to look at the audience. Now, most people have no problem calling the church Israel, thinking that the church is some sort of Judeo-Christian history, or that the church is Hebrew in part. Most people have no problem with that. Most people, when they read James 1, verse 1, it says, James, written to the 12 tribes, they think, oh, that's the church. 12 tribes, that's Israel. Well, they don't care, that's the church. Or when Hebrews chapter 8, for example, says the new covenant is made with the house of Israel and the house of Judah, they, that's the church. Doesn't matter. Most people just gloss over that. They have no issue with that. Okay, I have an issue with that. I hope you're persuaded in your mind about that as well, but most people don't have an issue with that. When 1 Peter 1 talks about the strangers of Israel, the strangers who are among the Gentiles, identifying his audience as Jews, and they say, oh, that's the church. Right. Or 1 Peter chapter 2, verse 7, when Peter calls his audience the holy priesthood, the royal generation that Exodus talks about, and they say, oh, that's the church. 1 Peter 2, verse 7. Okay. I have a problem with that verse because that's a promise that God gave to Israel, not to you and me. We're not priests. In fact, in none of Paul's epistles does he talk about priests and you being one. And someone in the back goes, Hebrews. Yeah, we don't know who wrote Hebrews. You see, yeah, but Hebrews talks about priests a lot. And so if Paul wrote Hebrews, it'd be the only place he talked about you being a part of a priestly covenant. Right? That's very odd. Okay, so it's just very strange. So when Brother Stamm thought that the kingdom believers became part of the body, I think that influenced who he thought wrote Hebrews, or at least vice versa. Okay, Brother Stamm, he thought that the kingdom believers, the 12 apostles, and all the people who were saved under Jesus' earthly ministry, or followed him rather in his message, kingdom message, that they all became part of the mystery body. And so he says, as I read to you earlier, that the two of the three purposes of the book of Hebrews is to talk about these Hebrews and how they're now part of the mystery body. You see, well, that's dangerous. That's very dangerous, I think, because Paul doesn't even talk about the mystery body in the book of Hebrews. But it also means that he intentionally thinks that Hebrews is putting us back under the new covenant. You see? And this is exactly what a lot of grace ministries do. They put the church back under the new covenant, back under the law, and people have confusion, misunderstanding as a result. Okay? So we have to look at the content of the book. We can't just say Paul wrote it and then apply everything to us. The doctrine doesn't line up with what Paul wrote in his other epistles. Okay? Most people who don't rightly divide, and some who do, think that the audience of Hebrews is Hebrew Christians, those Hebrew Christians, just like James 1:1, the 12 tribes. Those are written the Jewish Christians, right? It doesn't make any sense whatsoever. In Galatians 3:28, there is no Jew or Gentile in the body of Christ. And so how do you take the body of Christ and split it up and say, oh, Jewish Christians over here, please. I got message just for you, right? Gentile Christians over here, I got a message just for you guys. You can't give one group something that doesn't apply to the other group. In the body of Christ, we're all one, equal members of the body. Okay, we get all spiritual blessings from Christ. There's no Jew or Gentile. There's no special standing. We're all, Israel's fallen in this dispensation, just like the Gentiles are. And so to think that Hebrews is talking about a special position for Hebrew Christians that doesn't apply to Gentile Christians is wrong. And if you think it applies to Gentile Christians, then you're wrong again, because the doctrine is lowering your position in Christ. It's putting you under the covenant. So the audience can't be Hebrew Christians. It doesn't even make sense to talk about Hebrew Christians in the same way it doesn't make sense to talk about New Covenant Christians, because there are no Christians under the New Covenant. There are Jews and there are Gentiles. The name Christian didn't first get applied until the book of Acts, when it was called of Paul's converts in Antioch, Christians. Okay, they were first called Christians in Antioch. So Hebrew Christians doesn't make any sense. The audience of this book, the people who this book is written to, are under the law, that are under covenants. Not the old one, but the new one. Not the law of Moses, but the law of the new covenant written in their hearts. Okay? They've been promised a city, not the earthly city Jerusalem, which kicked them out and doesn't believe Jesus is the Messiah, but the heavenly city. They're waiting to come down from heaven, which sounds very much like Revelation 21. Okay? So you can see, if you think Hebrews is for you, you think you're in Revelation as well. And we see this in grace circles as well as Christianity at large. Okay? This error. All right. Priesthoods are all over Hebrews. And so the idea that of the priesthood of believers is written about in all seriousness and in publications from the Berean Society and Brother Stamm, that we are God's priests, okay, in this dispensation. That's simply not true. Paul never calls us priests in any of his epistles, okay? The only mediator today is Christ Jesus, and he's the head of the body, all right? He talks about deacons, talks about bishops, not priests, all right? Hebrews chapter 5, verse 9. Read this verse, and you tell me if this sounds like grace doctrine. Hebrews 5, verse 9. The Son was made perfect, and being made perfect, he became the author of eternal salvation unto all them that obey him. Does that sound like the gospel of the grace of God to you? The author of eternal salvation to all that obey him? Well, it's the obedience of faith. That's not what it sounded like. It sounds like obedience. And so, would it make sense if it's to all that obey him to think that Jesus is our pattern and example? And so we need to look back at Jesus' earthly ministry for our example of how to live a good life. And since we need to have faith and Christ is our example, maybe Christ needed to have faith. You ever heard that? Yeah, well, that is really easy to put you back under that and think that's true if you think that Hebrews 5 is written to you, that Jesus was made to be your example in his earthly ministry. Okay. Or as we studied this last Sunday, and Brother Kurth said the last couple of months, that we're supposed to be living our life as the Lord lived his life, you know. Can't do it. Impossible. But if you think Hebrews is written to the church, I can see where you may have that conclusion. Hebrews 5, verse 9. You got to obey him. You got to follow his pattern. Okay, look at Hebrews chapter 10, verse 38. Hebrews 10, 38. Now the just shall live by faith, but if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. Now Paul says the just shall live by faith in Romans 1. Right, but he kind of stops there. Hebrews 10:38 says, but if any man draw back, my soul shall have no pleasure in him. Draw back from what? Faith? So you have faith in the gospel, and then you fall back from faith in the gospel, and that what? God kicks you out? Is that what happens? In verse 39, but we are not of them who draw back unto perdition, but of them that believe to the saving of the soul. So there's two roads, the road of salvation, the road of perdition. Right? Which road are you on? And preachers preach it, right? From Hebrews 10:39. The gospel of the grace of God is all the work has been finished. You trust it. If you don't trust it, you're dead. If you trust it, you get life. There's no road. It's done. It's finished. You see? There's no road, but Hebrews 10:39, I think, very clearly teaches that sort of road idea. Okay? And it's up to you to endure to the end. You got to have the patience. In verse 36, you have need of patience that after you have done the will of God, you might receive the promise. After you've done the will of God, you receive the promise? I thought we were promised salvation the moment we believed. But Hebrews, once again, is the issue here. Okay, look at Hebrews chapter 12, verse 8. If ye be without chastisement, whereof all are partakers, then are ye bastards and not sons. Are you a son of God by faith in Christ Jesus? Romans chapter 8. Are you receiving chastisement from the Lord? If you're not, maybe you should question your position. Right? Hebrews 12 says that. Why is it saying that? And many people think that they should expect chastisement. The bad things in their life is chastisement for some sort of unconfessed sin. 1 John 1 verse 9, you have to confess your sins. Maybe we should ought to do that too. You say, so Hebrews 12 talks about chastisement. This issue confuses people if you think the church is for you. Hebrews 12, you think the church is talk about in Hebrews there. Hebrews chapter 12 and verse 28. Wherefore, we receiving a kingdom which cannot be moved, let us have grace whereby we may serve God acceptably with reverence and godly fear. For our God is a consuming fire. Is that the picture of your head? You receiving a kingdom? Say, oh, this is talking about the spiritual kingdom, not the earthly kingdom. Well, then what's Hebrews 13 verse 14 talk about? We have no continuing city, but we seek one to come. We seek a city to come, a kingdom to come to earth. Right, a city to come. It sounds to me as talking about God's promised New Jerusalem, which is what it's talking about there, okay? The audience, the book of Hebrews, are related to the fathers and the prophets. Hebrews 1, 1 and 2 says that. God spoke on sundry times to the prophets and to the fathers, but now he's speaking through his son. The audience of Hebrews is related to the prophets and the fathers. You have no relationship to the prophets and the fathers. You are strangers of the covenants. You have no hope, Ephesians 2 verse 12, apart from Christ and his blood by his grace. Okay? It's interesting, you read the book of Hebrews, it mentions the people, Moses and Joseph from Genesis, not Jesus' earthly parent. But Moses and Joseph from Genesis are mentioned more in Hebrews than any other book in the Bible except for Acts chapter 7, or the New Testament rather, any other book in the New Testament except for Acts chapter 7, where Stephen, who's ministering to Israel, preaches about Moses and Joseph and the angels that gave Israel the law, but they failed to keep it. And what's Hebrews talk about? Moses and Joseph and angels, how they delivered the law to Israel and they failed to keep it. That's interesting. If I didn't know better, maybe Stephen wrote this book, right? But I don't know better. I don't know who wrote the book. Could have been Stephen, okay? You mean before he died? He was in prison before he died, wasn't he? Hey, that's a thought. I don't know. Maybe Philip. Peter was in prison too. So you see, we simply just can't know. And the content of the book matches very much the kingdom ministry, the Pentecostal ministry. Hebrews 2, 3, and 4 says so much. In Hebrews 2, 3, and 4. How shall we escape if we neglect so great salvation, which at the first, what salvation are you talking about? At the first began to be spoken by the Lord. The Lord in his earthly ministry? Well, that's not the gospel of the grace of God. Began to be spoken by the Lord and was confirmed unto us by them that heard him. Well, who heard the Lord when he preached? 12 apostles. So Hebrews 2 and 3 is talking about this salvation preached by Jesus in his earthly ministry at Pentecost. Do you think Paul's the author here? You see, it's very hard to squeeze him in there. You see, what's Brother Stam do with that? Well, he really generalizes that and says he's talking about general salvation, nothing specific. And so, you know, even though Jesus came and preached the gospel of the kingdom and preached the law and the covenants, he did preach to Israel salvation from sins. You know, he was the Savior to Israel. So Hebrews just talking about general salvation, putting Paul right in line with Peter's ministry. In Hebrews 2 verse 4, God also bearing them witness both with signs and wonders and diverse miracles and gifts of the Holy Ghost. Is that Pentecost? Sounds like it. Paul wasn't there. Okay? But Hebrews, the author of Hebrews, puts himself in that context, under those covenants, in that ministry. Okay? So, these Hebrews, the audience of this book, under covenants and a law, have some things in common with the church. But they're different. We talked about this on Sunday a couple weeks ago. Okay? The thing they have in common with the church is the Spirit of grace. Well, we preach the gospel of the grace of God. And we have the Spirit dwelling in us, so there's something in common. There's some things in common. You know what's in common? Is that they're no longer under the old law. You're not under the law at all. That's in common. But you know what? They go from not being under the old law to being under a new law. They go from not being under an old covenant to being under a new covenant. They go from not being the Israel who rejected Jesus and God to the Israel that receives Jesus and God, the Israel special standing with God. you're not Israel at all, right? You have no covenants. You're not under the law, but you do get grace, just like the Hebrews get grace. See, so they have some things in common with the church, but they're different. And that's the things we need to recognize, their differences. So most likely the parallels between the book of Hebrews and early Acts suggest someone from the remnant of Israel wrote it. That's what I think. You persuade it in your own mind. I don't know who it is exactly, but someone associated with Israel's little flock, I think, wrote the book of Hebrews. You say who? I don't know. It doesn't say. The Bible doesn't say. That's what the content, what the doctrinal material is about. It's about the little flock of Israel, about the remnant of Israel. It's not about the mystery body of Christ. Okay? If Paul was the author, then he wrote an epistle not to Gentiles. When he was the apostle of the Gentiles and promised to go to the heathen, he wrote an epistle not to them, in private, anonymously, about the kingdom gospel and the earthly covenants, claiming to be a part of the city and the people to come. That's very odd. Why would he do that? Right? I don't know why really he would do that. And if you are a recipient of the doctrine in Hebrews, you say, well, the Hebrews is written to us. We're in there somewhere. Then you're going to make yourself spiritual Israel. You're putting yourself under covenants. You're going to be associated with Israel's New Testament law. You're going to be associated with Israel's kingdom. And you're going to be under a conditional position of salvation. You're going to be under chastisement of the Lord. And you've got to overcome to enter into rest and salvation. Good luck with that. Right? Like, it's much easier to understand the content of the books written to the little flock of Israel. Okay, and it's not given to us by direction of our apostle. Okay, whether he wrote it or not, it doesn't apply to us. You see? Any question, any comments about the authorship? Didn't really answer the question, but, you know. Gave you the issues. Hopefully that helps. Okay, let's say a prayer and wrap it up then. Lord, we thank you for the truth you've given us in your word and the complete position we have in you. And we thank you that you've given us all spiritual blessings through your son. And so we know what it looks like to see a religion being taught. And as we study the book of Hebrews, I pray that we would appreciate more your promises to them, but would also appreciate just as much your free gift to us and your complete assurance you've given us in this dispensation, that we would use that wisely and use our liberty to see souls saved and see each other edified. Amen. Thank you, folks.